Morning, everyone. It's good to see you here as we worship God together. I just want to read from Romans chapter 15 as I did last week, the last verses. And again, Isaiah says, "The root of Jesse will spring up, one who will arise to rule over the nations. To him the Gentiles will hope. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit." We're going to worship God together as we sing our opening hymn, which is "How Lovely on the Mountains Our God Reigns." Let's stand together and worship God in song. Please be seated. We're going to continue to worship God as we pray together. Heavenly Father, we adore you, we worship you, we give thanks for all that you are and you mean to us. We thank you, Lord, that you're a God who is faithful and true and kind and generous of heart. And so, Lord God, we come to you today as the one who holds all things together in Christ Jesus, the one who created the heavens and the earth, the Lord God who is sovereign over all the universe and all things. We come to you, O God. knowing that you are not just a God who is transcendent, but a God who is imminent, a God who is close to us, a God who wants to commune and share heart with each one of us. And so, Father God, we come to you as our Abba. We come to you as the one who knows us and whose arms are always open wide. And we are thankful that your character is steadfast. And we are thankful that you are a faithful God. Lord, as we come into your presence, we can also become aware of ourselves. And we feel, Lord, at times, broken and heartache has taken over. And we feel, Lord, that we have wandered and done our own things. But also, Lord, help us to remember that in Christ all things have been finished. That the Lamb of God has taken away the sin of the whole world, and he was successful. Lord, help us to enjoy our company with you. Help us not to be weighed down with things that would make us feel ashamed or heartbroken, but help us, Lord, just to lift our head and to appreciate the magnitude of your grace and your mercy. Lord, set us free in Christ Jesus for liberty's sake. And so, Lord, we come here today with thanksgiving in our heart. We are a grateful people for all that we have. Lord, just help us to stop and just share our gratitude out of the depths of our being for who you are, for all that we have. Lord, it's easy for us to grumble and complain. It's easy for us, Lord, just to fall into that path. And forgive us, Lord, that we haven't been a grateful people, that we haven't looked for the things that are positive in life, and instead we have been weighed down by all the things that we haven't got. So, Lord, we bless you this day. We thank you for your presence here with us, and we ask, Lord, that as we commune together in song and in words and in prayers and in Holy Communion, we pray, Lord God, that we will be so transformed and excited in our faith that we will go into this week and the rest of this day with a sense of hope and peace and joy in our heart. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Lord, we pray together now the prayer that you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Just before Michael comes, I'm going to just light the Advent candles. Okay, so we're going to light the first one. What's the first one signify? A wee bit later. Thank you very much. Okay, so there's the hope one from last week. And so this week we're going to light the second candle. Do you know what that is? A bit later.
Peace.
There we go. So there's no point in preaching then. You already know it and know what it is. Well, we pray that God's hope and peace will be with us all today, and we'll have a real sense of his presence with us. So Michael's going to come now and bring the announcements.
Morning, everyone. Wish you all a very warm welcome this morning to our service of communion, and welcome to anyone watching online as well this morning on YouTube. Next Sunday, our normal service at 11 a.m., and Alan will be leading that. This week, there's no midweek prayer meeting on Wednesday evening, and GB are as per normal with the girls at the normal times, the different sections. You're probably aware the Christmas postal service is up and running, but next Sunday is the last date for putting your cards in for it to be delivered then the following Sunday due to COVID restrictions. And just to give you aware of some of the Christmas services, the next Sunday the 19th will be our carol service at the usual time, 11 a.m. On Christmas Day, 10 a.m. service. And then on Sunday the 26th, there won't be a service that Sunday. There's also a box out in the porch for stamps, used stamps for the leprosy mission that is collected. So just to remind you of that, if you have any used stamps, especially this time of year, you tend to get more post for some reason. You use stamps to bring them and put them in the wee box on the porch for leprosy mission. And there's also anyone who wants envelopes for next year to let Jane or John know if they require new envelopes for next year. Also, there's a box of lateral flow tests out in the porch if anybody needs them for any reason to test themselves. We've got them delivered this morning. And so just lift them the way out if you want and need lateral flow test to check yourself for COVID. And finally, just a word of thanks from Michelle, just from all the love and support she's had over the last week, from everyone here at Jennymount and everyone who attended Tommy's funeral and helped in any way. Just thanks from Michelle and all the family. And she thanks us all for supporting her at this sad time. That's all the announcements this morning, and Rhoda's going to come now and read.
Our reading today is taken from Philippians 1, verses 1 to 11. Paul and Timothy, servants of Christ Jesus, to all the saints in Christ Jesus at Philippi, together with the overseers and deacons, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God every time I remember you in all my prayers for all of you. I always pray with joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. It is right for me to feel this way about all of you, since I have you in my heart, for whether I am in chains or defending and confirming the gospel, all of you share in God's grace with me. God can testify how I long for all of you with the affection of Christ Jesus. And this is my prayer, that your love may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight, so that you may be able to discern what is best and may be pure and blameless until the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ, to the glory and praise of God.
Thanks, Rhoda. Let's just pray together and we'll give thanks for all the gifts and pray that they will bless the hearts of those who get them. Heavenly Father, before we hear your word this morning, we just want to give thanks for all these gifts. Lord, in giving, we receive. And also, Lord, for each person that's going to receive a gift this Christmas, we pray, Lord, that you will bless them, that they will be touched in their heart, and they will rejoice in the fact that they have received something, Lord, that's been given with the hand of love. So, Lord, we bless BCM and all the work that's carried out there, and as they prepare to give out toys around the country and around Belfast the next few days, we pray, Lord, that you will be with all those volunteers who help sort them and put them ready for the young people to receive. Lord, as we listen to your word now, we pray, Lord, that you will help us to discern what you're saying to our hearts today. And that in our listening, we will listen with the inner ear. That, Lord, we will know you communing with us in the depths of our being. We want to hear what you have to say to us this day. In Jesus' name, amen. I mean, as I said there, today is the second Sunday in Advent, and today I've decided to focus mostly on the epistle reading of the lectionary, which is Philippians chapter 1 that Rhoda just read for us, rather than the gospel reading. And from straight away in chapter 1 of verse 1, we can see that Paul follows the sort of standard format of a letter writing in that particular time. We know in our format is Dear Billy or whatever, Yours sincerely, Alan. You know, that sort of standard format. And when you break that now, when the email came in, you started going, hey. Most people don't say dear, usually when they're writing an email now. But in a formal letter, you still know the rules, and you stick to them. Well, there was a standard letter format, and Paul was writing letters to the saints and to the of a particular church. And he goes through the standard format. There is the sender. He says, Paul and Timothy, slaves of Christ. So he expounds that a wee bit. And then he writes down the recipients, to the saints and the leaders of the church in Philippi. And then you would have, normally you would have the word greetings in Greek. So there would be a sort of thing making it clear that you're just greetings. That would be it. That would be the opening line. But Paul changes that. And that change is significant because he writes grace and peace. Can you hear me okay? Yeah? All right. Just that people were looking at me there as if they couldn't hear me and I thought I was talking into the air. Okay, so grace and peace means that Paul is trying to say something significant here because he's changed the standard format. And it tells us what's important to Paul. Grace, the unmerited favor of God, that God is the initiator of love, and peace, which we're focusing on today. And peace is another one of those words which has a range of meaning for us as it does for Paul. Paul, being a Jew, would have used the word shalom. Shalom would have been his greeting. But shalom has a broader idea and is a broader concept than the word peace. When we say peace, we usually mean the end of war or the end of hostility. We mean things like peace treaties, you know, like the Treaty of Versailles after the First World War. But shalom conveys more than the end of war. It points to this harmonious balance in the universe, wholeness between God. If you were looking at it like a triangle, God at the top, the earth on my left, and people, human beings on my right. And that triangle is shalom, a sense of wholeness. So it means more than the absence of war or the absence of hostilities. Peace can be understood then from two perspectives. It can be seen as something external. You know, the end of troubles, the end of conflict, or the end of war. And also as something internal. Now you can have an external peace. There can be peace all around you. But you can still be anxious and distressed within. This happened to a lot of people after the troubles. You know, when the Good Friday Agreement came in and the troubles seemed to stop, some people who had lived their life around the troubles found it difficult to adjust to not having troubles because that's what they were conditioned into and what they were used to. So you can have an external peace, but no internal peace. But also you can have an internal peace in the midst of chaos. Every time I say this, I always think of Rafiki. You know, I don't know why, but you know Rafiki's sitting there. It doesn't matter what the chaos, you don't know who Rafiki is. Rafiki and the Lion King, you know, the wee character. Am I alone here? you don't have Netflix in your or TV. All right, you can have TV, you know, those days are gone. An internal peace, like where there's conflict all around you, but there's something at peace inside yourself. Shalom is both external and internal peace. That might be a good way of sort of understanding it. Paul writes about both these types of peace. We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And Jesus said, "My peace I give you." And in Christ then, we can have an objective external peace. A gracious gift from God. The words that I said at the beginning, quoting from John 1, the Lamb of God has taken away the sin of the world, and he was successful. Jesus cried, "It is finished. It is done." The Lamb of God has taken away the sin of the world. We are accepted in the Beloved. This is the peace that we declare when we share at communion. We talk about sharing the peace. What we're doing is we're rejoicing in what Christ has done. It doesn't depend on how we feel. It doesn't depend on how well our performance is as a Christian or as how we think it is. It all depends on him. He has done it all. He is the source and the focus, and we rejoice that we are accepted in him. And we also, at the communion table, we look forward to the second advent when peace externally will be the norm. There'll be no more hostilities. The lion will lie with the lamb. All the things that we looked at when we were talking last week. So we have this objective, external peace in Christ, which is a gift from God. And the call of the good news is to wake up and enjoy and receive this gift. It's as simple as that, if you want to enjoy it. I mean, it's like God standing with a present in his hand here and going like this here. Here you go. But unless you take it and receive it, you don't enjoy it. It's still there. The gift is still there. But it's waking up and enjoying the gift. And so the external peace that Jesus Christ completed in what we talk about in sermons and what we proclaim in the Word of God is the source of the internal peace. And the internal peace is what we long for as well. Peace is a gift. And as the song of Zechariah says, it is also a way of life. You can read that in Luke 1 and 79. The external peace is sorted. Let's get that clear. It's a fact. And it provides us with a confidence and a sure foundation on our spiritual journey. That we are loved. That we are loved, full stop. That we love because God first loved us. But peace is also something that we pursue. It's something that we be peacemakers. Something also that we have as we can have an inner peace, but an inner peace that can easily be disrupted in this life by bitterness and by trouble. These are the usual things that rob us in some way of an inner peace. So let's just turn to Philippians again. And Joe, if you could find chapter 4 of Philippians, verses 5 and 6, the words that are well known. Philippians 4, 5 and 6. I should have given it earlier. The Philippian church is under persecution. The Philippian church is in internal strife. And so Paul is writing this letter to the church because of these conditions within the church, strife within and strife without. It's a church that needs to hear about peace and also joy. And so he writes to them and he says in just threw me there. All right, that there's not working. Okay, the Lord is near is the word I want you to pick up here. If we are stuck in life, in trouble and in difficulty, no matter what that trouble is, how it looks, whether you're worried about Brexit or you're worried about COVID or you're worried about just the state of the world or you've got personal loss and heartache today, where we always begin is the Lord is near. Before we do anything else, it's that affirmation. The Lord is near now. All that matters is right now. The past is gone. We can't change it. Can't change 5 minutes ago. Right now, in this breath, the Lord is near. Closer than your breath, the Lord is near. We always start there. It's we move from the troubles and we fix our mind on Christ. We set our minds on peace, on love, on joy, on kindness, and the reminder that we are loved by God. Don't be distracted by the troubles in this life. We don't deny them, but we do not be distracted by them. So Paul affirms first to this people who are struggling with strife, the Lord is near. Savor that moment. Savor it now. The Lord is here and his spirit is in us. And that is good news. And then Paul says in the next verse, do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. So we know the Lord is near. He is closer than our breath. He is in us. And then we can commune easy with the Lord. We can begin to share our trouble with him. And the result of this turning and fixing our minds on God, and the result of us actually articulating maybe just how we feel, we may just want to cry. But just as we sit there, and we know he is near, and we just begin to commune with him, guess what? Verse 7 follows. And this is the key here. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. We don't have to slug it out alone in the trenches of trouble in this world. We can experience a deep inner peace beyond thinking, a peace beyond words, as we fix our minds and our attention on Christ. It will not remove the trouble. In this world, you will have trouble, but thanks be to God, Jesus says, I have overcome the world. In fixing our minds in Christ, hope arises and we have a sense of peace. Prayer itself is a relationship. And if we misunderstand prayer as being just about words, we're missing something vital about what prayer is. In prayer, we can move, like any relationship, we move from communication to communion and then to union. Relationships deepen. Relationships do not, you know, the more you get to know someone, the less you have to communicate with, or speak with them. It actually is a deepening relationship. I've shared this before. The more intimate you are with someone, the less you have to say. It can be more eye contact and body language that speaks. And it is that with God. So our relationship with God deepens. And we move into less words. And there's a growing intimacy with God that leads to a peace beyond words and beyond our understanding. So we start always, and that's what we do when we gather here today, to fix our attention on the Lord, the one who is near, the one who is in you. And we share our heart with words and then begin to move to a deeper silence as we wait on the Lord. You know, it's sad that we limit prayer to words. It is words. Of course it's words. Help me. It's the best prayer you can ever cry out. But it's much more. And so people get put off by prayer because we have standardized it and we've made a format. But prayer is about your heart. So I don't want you to be put off when I talk about prayer. People can be put off about with prayer. You want to get a formula of words. It's not. It's just about your heart intention. And sometimes you just can't speak. And the verse that struck me in today's reading is Philippians 1, verse 7. And I'm hoping that you take this away today. Paul's writing to this church. He's talking to them. He's giving them the greetings. He's encouraging them. And he just wants to bless them, the saints in Philippi. And he goes in verse 7. It is right for me to feel this way about all of you. And it's this bit, since I have you in my heart. That's it. Since I have you in my heart. What Paul is saying to this church is that I hold you in my heart. I hold you in my heart. And the heart is where we experience deep peace. This is almost one of those comments that just seems like a passing comment. I hold you in my heart. But actually what it does is, it points us back to a verse in the Old Testament. And it's in Exodus 28 and 29. And when you see this, you'll appreciate where I'm going with this sermon. Exodus 28 and 29. And it's talking about Aaron, the high priest. When Aaron enters the holy place, he will bear the names of the sons of Israel over his heart on the breastpiece of decision as a continuing memorial before the Lord. I'll say it again. Whenever Aaron enters the holy place, he will bear the names of the sons of Israel over his heart on the breastpiece of decision as a continuing memorial before the Lord. Now, they're all right, well done, Joe. This is the garb of the high priest in Israel. And there you can see, there's the 12 stones, or they're actual precious stones on the breastpiece. Okay? And each one of those is of the tribe of Israel, the 12 tribes of Israel. All right. And so when the priest himself is actually dressed in the same clothes and the same material as the tabernacle. So the priest himself is a walking tabernacle. And he's a walking tabernacle, a walking temple, and he holds the children of Israel on the breastpiece. He puts their name as he goes into the presence of the Lord. So he symbolically held the people close to his heart continually before the Lord. So this is not a head thing. This is not a theology degree. This is not more knowledge for the sort of great biblical pub quiz in the sky or Trivial Pursuit or whatever. It's a heart thing. And it's so powerfully symbolically demonstrated in this picture. It's not about words, but the symbol gathers the intention of the heart. He doesn't have to say anything. He's holding it before the Lord. And so Paul, he is like this high priest. He is thinking back to this. He knows the Old Testament through and through, Paul. And he's saying to them, I hold you Philippians in my heart. This holding of people in our heart, carrying people's name or the image of their face in our heart, is prayer. It is prayer. It's all we need to say. And furthermore, Jesus, our high priest, he is called the high priest in Hebrews. And so when Jesus says, I make intercession continually for you before the Father, before Trinity God, in Trinity God, he's saying he holds us in his heart, just like the high priest held the people of God before his heart. This is prayer. This is what prayer is all about. We have an objective peace with God. It is a done deal. It is finished. It's like a treaty. It's signed, sealed. Well, that's Stevie Wonder. Signed, seen, delivered. Jesus has made reconciliation between God and humanity and the whole universe. The triangle is shalom because of what Christ has done. We have peace with God, full stop. But we can enjoy this peace. We can enjoy it as we waken up to the good news, but we can also enjoy it subjectively and internally as we grow in intimacy and we learn to trust this God, that this God really, really does love us. And he gets bigger and bigger. He no longer gets limited to Protestants. He's no longer limited to one particular group. He becomes so massive. And you can never go back because you start seeing him everywhere. And it blows your head away that this God loves us so much. All of us. And we can experience the peace that passes understanding because he is near. He's not a God in the heavens. He's in you. The Lord is near. He is with us and in us. Emmanuel. And so this inner experience that I'm talking about is more like a peace process. Where we have received the gift that's finished, it's a treaty, we're now in a peace process. Something internal. It's to guide our feet into the way of peace. And this way of peace will include holding people in our heart. We all are priests. And this will change us and bless us. It will stop bitterness and maintain the peace that passes understanding. And this is prayer. The hardest thing in the world to do is to mention the name of someone that you're fighting with. Isn't it? No, Dina, you just can't. Even if you fall out with your significant other, you can barely say their name. It's great there. I'm in a fight at the minute. I can't say it. But I can hold her in my heart. Hold her face in my heart. It's a lot easier. And it melts you. And it begins to get to you when you hold someone in your heart. And all you're doing is holding them. Your intention of heart is what matters, not the words. And so today, as we approach communion, I want us now to pray. And so I'm going to lead us in prayer. So let's pray. Let's be still for a moment. And if you're feeling a bit tense, just relax by breathing in deeply. Just take one big breath and then breathe it out slowly. And just remind yourself, as I say it, that the Lord is near. The Lord is here. He is in you now. He's in your heart. And as we sit here, I encourage you to bring into your imagination someone that you want to pray, whether it's a friend or an enemy, or someone you know who's hurting. And then slowly move that image or that name from your head and put it into your heart. And just hold it in your heart. Because God knows their deepest needs before you ask. God knows their desires. All you do is hold them in your heart before the Lord. This is not a mental thing. This is a love thing. It's a heart thing. So just hold the person's face. Hold their name in your heart. Don't worry if your mind wanders or if you're a bit self-conscious. Don't worry. Your intention is enough. Let's be still for a moment and hold them there. Lord, we come to you because, Lord, we know that you hold us in your heart. That in Christ Jesus we have a high priest, and each one of our names is held in his heart. And Lord, because of that, we are thankful. We want to be like you, Lord, and we want to hold others in our heart. Lord, we are not heard because of our multitude of words. We are heard because of our intention to love. And so, Father God, as we commune with you together here today, we pray for the leaders of this world. We pray for those in authority and positions where they can influence change, that you will give them wisdom, Lord. And we hold in our country the First and Deputy First Minister before you as they would lead the executive. Lord, in your mercy. And Lord, we pray for all those who are working to improve our vaccination system, those who are doing research to find out how to overcome the Omicron variant, and all the work that people do in laboratories, behind the scenes. We pray, Lord, for them, for all those who work in the NHS, for all those who are part of the whole operation of providing the vaccines. We are grateful, Lord. Forgive us for moaning for what we have. Help us, Lord, to be grateful and hold the NHS just before you in our heart. Lord, in your mercy. And Lord, for those who are gathered today as they approach Christmas, who are in countries across this world where they are persecuted for their faith, Lord, we can come here. We can choose to be here. We can watch online. We can even choose not to come, Lord. But they have no option. And so, Lord, we identify with them this morning. And we mention people in North Korea and other countries where there is no liberty of worship. Lord, in your mercy. And Lord, for all among us who are brokenhearted today, whether they're struggling with bereavement and mourning, whether they're tortured in mind with mental health difficulties, whether there is relationship breakup, whether there is just sickness of body, we mention them to you now, Lord, in our heart. Lord, we are thankful. Thankful that we can come to you and open our hearts to you. For Christ's sake. Amen. Amen. Can I encourage you to be creative about this? I'm a sort of an abstract person, and so I think and pick, you know, the names and language and things like that. But some people are really creative. If you can write on rice, You're one of those people that can write on rice. Right when you write someone's name, or write someone's name on a stone, or carry a picture of someone. You know, we used to the idea of women carrying lockets and things. You know, the idea of carrying something close to your heart. Or maybe if you're praying, you don't have to say words. Just take their picture and put it to your heart, and it might be how you communicate. Because we're all different. Some people are more symbolic. Some people like to do something. But you're only limited by your own creativity. Write a list of names, maybe, of people. Paint pictures of them. Put my name on your list. And can't get enough prayer, can you? Like, and have people holding you by your heart. But I'm saying to you this. Go this afternoon. Try and be creative. You only have to do it for one person. If you want to do it for more, that's up to you. Carry it. I mean, I love giving people crosses. Because if you carry it, sometimes that just says everything. You don't have to use words. We're moved by symbols, so let's not be afraid, because it conveys our prayer and the intention of our heart. We're going to go into communion now with the great symbol that we have of the body and blood of Christ. So if you want to take your container, couldn't get a word there. And we're going to go into the communion service. So let's stand together, and we're going to join together as we share the peace. Let's stand. And if you haven't got one of those containers, just put your hand up and Michael will try and get one to you. May the God of peace make you holy and keep you free from every fault as you wait in joyful hope for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The peace of the Lord be always with you. And you can kiss the person beside you if they're in your bubble, but for everybody else, you can just wave at, okay? All right, you can shake hands, share the peace as you wish. You don't have to kiss, that's up to you. Okay, we're going to join together and we're going to stand as we say go through the great hymn of thanksgiving. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. God of all glory, and light of our salvation, we offer you thanks and praise through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. By your living word, you called all things into being, breathed into life the desire of your heart, and shaped us in your own likeness. Though we rejected your love, you did not give us up, or cease to fashion our salvation. You made a covenant to be our God, spoke to us through the prophets, and prepared the way for our redemption. We praise you that in the fullness of time, you sent your only Son, Jesus Christ, the Lord of eternity, announced by angels and born of Mary. He became incarnate, fulfilling the promise of your salvation. And so we offer our praise with all your people on earth and in heaven. With the full chorus of your creation, we proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord. Amen. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And you may be seated as we continue through the service, which will appear behind me. We praise you, Lord God, King of the universe, through our Lord Jesus Christ, who on the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, he gave thanks, and he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, take this and eat it. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, he gave thanks, and he gave it to them, saying, drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. We say together, Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. He is Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the King of kings and the Lord of lords. Recalling his death and resurrection, and in obedience to his command, we celebrate the offering of his eternal sacrifice until he comes again. Through him, our priest and king, accept us as a living sacrifice, a people for your praise. Generous and holy God, pour out your Spirit that these gifts of bread and wine may be for us the body and blood of Christ. Refashion us in your image, that we may be found ready at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Blessing and honor and glory and power be yours, O Lord, forever and ever. Amen. And the bread we break is a sharing in the body of Christ, and the cup we take is a sharing in the blood of Christ. Happy are those who share the banquet. And so then, let us come together and let us eat and drink this in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. The true bread of heaven gives life to the world. Come all who are hungry, come and eat. Come all who are thirsty, come and drink. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ, keep us in eternal life. Amen. We eat together. And now we share together in the wine. And it's the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was shed for us for the forgiveness of sins. Drink this in remembrance of him. Amen. Let's just be still again for a moment, knowing that the Lord God holds you, unique person that you are, in his heart. He doesn't have to say anything. He just holds you in his heart. And so hold someone else in your heart. Let us pray. We join together in the words on the screen. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for feeding us with the bread of heaven and the cup of salvation. Keep us in your grace, and at the coming of Christ in glory, bring us with your saints into the life of your kingdom. Amen. And we're going to worship God together, and we're going to sing our closing hymn, which is Faithful One. So let's stand together and we'll sing it through twice.
Son of Righteousness shine upon us and prepare our hearts and souls to meet him when he comes in glory.
And the blessing of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be ours now and always. Amen. And we share and bless each other with the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Amen. God bless. Thank you.